God, that would have been hilarious. Someday it's going to happen, but I just hope it's not at my expense. You know what I mean? Oh, my. Well, it's good to see you this morning. It really is. If you need a Bible this morning, these gentlemen around would love to place one in your hand. And feel free to slip up your hand. They'll make sure that you receive one. That way you can follow along this morning. We're in Joshua chapter 11. And it's amazing to me that it's been a few weeks now since our accident, and clarity of mind starts to become more and more of an acceptability for me, I know. Last Sunday, I didn't go check the mail even one time, so that was good. So that's a blessing. You have to be thankful for the things you're thankful for. I'm also thankful, Karen and I both are thankful for the cards and the expressions of compassion that y'all have showered us with, and we really appreciate the cards and the prayers. Now, one card that I did get was from a cat, and somebody, I won't name them, but they have a cat, and they decided to write this card from the cat's perspective. So they had letters backwards and different things encouraging me to be like a cat and get rest and all that kind of good stuff. So I appreciated that as well. That was very creative, actually. But it made me think about this couple, the whole cat thing. This couple was getting dressed to go out for the evening one night, and they turned on their nightlight, and they turned on the answering machine, all that kind of stuff, and they covered their pet parakeet with a blanket, and they put the cat in the backyard, and they called the cab company to come pick him up, and the cab pulled up to the curb. And as they were going out the front door, the cat came around from the backyard and dove in the front door. So all of a sudden they realized, you know, this is a bit of a dilemma because the cat always tries to eat the bird. So that was a problem. So the wife said, I'll go down to the taxi and tell him, you know, that you need to go back inside. So the wife does that, and she goes down to talk to the driver, and she doesn't want him to know that the house is empty. So she explains to the taxi driver, her husband will be out soon. He's just going upstairs to say goodbye to her mother. Well, a few minutes later, the husband comes down and he gets into the cab and he says, hey, sorry I took so long. He says, as they drive away, he says, the stupid jerk was hiding under the bed, so I had to poke it with a coat hanger to get her to come out. And then I had to wrap her up in a blanket so she wouldn't scratch me. But it all worked out. He says, I hauled her butt downstairs and threw her out in the backyard. Well, we are in Joshua chapter 11 this morning. And as we look at Joshua chapter 11, we're going to be just camping out here for a few moments in chapter 11, verse 21, on down through the end of this chapter. And this is a passage of Scripture, I think, that is very easy for us to read over. And there are those flyover passages of Scripture, certainly, where as you're reading, you just kind of come to the end. There's been all these spectacular victories that have been won. God has been doing some amazing things. I popped that map back up there for you to see it again. You can see where the people of Israel cross over the Jordan River, and they defeated some really formidable foes on the eastern side of the Jordan on their way north, and now they've come to Jericho. That was not a problem. God brings the walls down of a fortified city that was impregnable. They go up to Ai, and after they sorted out the sin in the camp, they're able to see a victory in Ai. And then that follows with a five-king coalition that comes against them that was daunting. And God allowed them to have the victory that day, and it was a tremendous victory. You remember Joshua going to the Lord and praying that the daylight would continue so that they could win the whole day, and that's what that happened. And these are tremendous, tremendous victories. And then you come to chapter 11, we looked at it last week, where there's this enormous battlefield. And the Bible says that the enemy had just amassed such a force that it was like the sand of the seashore. It was just innumerable. And it was incredible how they won the victory there. So when you get through reading all of these things, it's really easy to come to verse 21 and just kind of skim through those last three verses. But I don't want to do that this morning, because I think if I do that, you'll miss out on a tremendous blessing. The Bible says Joshua came at that time, and he cut off the Anakim from the hill country, from Hebron to Debir, And you can notice up there on the map, Hebron, Debir. From Anab and from all the hill country of Judah and from all the hill country of Israel, Joshua utterly destroyed them with their cities. And there were no Anakim left in the land of the sons of Israel. Only in Gaza, Gath, and Ashdod some remained. So Joshua took the whole land according to all the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance to Israel according to their divisions by their tribes. Thus the land had rest from war. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. God, we just want to give you praise and thanks for this passage. Lord, we're going to look at this passage now and we're going to see how complete this victory truly is. We're going to see how amazing, Lord, the things that you did in the sight of the Israelites were. And we're going to understand, Lord, that even the most ferocious enemy can be put to defeat by your mighty hand. So, Lord, you lead us, I pray. Lead us to do things for your honor and glory. Lead us, Lord, so that we might be pleasing to you, willing to step out in faith and follow you, and, Father, not be paralyzed by fear, I pray. In Christ's name, amen. Well, this passage of Scripture is a neat passage of Scripture because as you come to the end of chapter 11, you're kind of coming to the conclusion of all of this recorded material. And you'll notice here that the passage that we just read in verse 21, the Anakites are mentioned. These are warriors of great renown. They were very significant in the history of Israel. In fact, their fearsome presence had been the cause of some pretty big issues for Israel over the years. The people of Israel have won this victory because of God and God exclusively. In fact, this is God's victory, is it not? And so it's fitting when you come to verses 21 through 23 that the chronicle here of Israel's conquest should really end up with the account of triumph over perhaps Israel's greatest feared enemy, the giants of the land. The cities that he mentions are cities that we can find on the map, and it's from these cities that Joshua drove out all of this tremendous enemy, these giants. We look at this passage of Scripture, and the Bible says Joshua came at this time and he cut off. Now, the word cut off is an interesting word because it's a strong term. It means to basically totally uproot, to pull out entirely, or to exterminate something. And this is the type of verbiage that's being used here. The enemy were exterminated at the hand of Almighty God. God had done a tremendous, tremendous work here. We notice that there is something to praise God for that we don't want to overlook because these giants are extremely important. All of us face difficulties in our Christian life. And one of the ways that Satan causes us to become immobilized is through fear. Now, he does it a lot of different ways. Sometimes it's sin that paralyzes us. Sometimes it's unconfessed sin that we just want to hold on to, and we become spiritually neutral for God because of that sin. But oftentimes it's something as simple as fear. Fear that grips our hearts, that causes us to be paralyzed so that we don't move forward in the pathway that God has set before us. How easy it is for Satan to recognize our weaknesses. And one of the weaknesses that stand out for all of us as followers of Jesus Christ is that of fear. And what Satan has done is over the years, he's been very skilled at causing us to face various giants. And in the case historically of the people of Israel, they dealt with giants frequently. In fact, you don't have to go there, but Genesis chapter 14 mentions several different giants. It says in the 14th year of Chedorlaomer and the kings that were with him, they came and attacked, the Bible says, the Rephaim and Asheroth, the Zuzim and Ham, the Amim and Shavah, and in En Mishpat, and they attacked all the country of the Amalekites and also the Amorites who dwelt in Hazazon and Tamar. And this is all recorded in Genesis chapter 14, verses 5 through 7. Now, Genesis chapter 14 does not reveal who those forces are, the Rephaim and the Zuzim and the Anim, the Amorites, but we read about them in other places in the Old Testament, and so we become familiar with who they actually are. And we say, oh, okay, those references all the way back in Genesis chapter 14 are actually references to giants. The Amorites are mentioned in Scripture some 80 plus times. And they are oftentimes mentioned. Some were actually allied with Abraham back in Genesis 14, 13. But they were the descendants of Noah's grandson, Canaan. And they're recorded about with regard to their being in the minor prophets. When you come to the minor prophets, there's a lot that's said about these giants. In fact, Amos chapter 2 says this. It says, "Yet it was I," and this is speaking of God, "who destroyed the Amorite before them, whose height," speaking of the Amorites, "was like the height of the cedars, and he was as strong as the oaks. Yet I destroyed his fruit above and his roots beneath." That's Amos chapter 2. And so these were part of the difficulty that the people of Israel faced. The Anim are mentioned in Deuteronomy chapter 2. Literally, the terminology there is terrors. These were giants as well, and they were the source of great fear at different times. The Zamim or Zuzim in Genesis chapter 14 are mentioned more entirely as well over there in Deuteronomy chapter 2. And so it's not unusual to look at these various usages of terms that describe giants in the Old Testament. Rephaim is one of the most common terms that's used in the Old Testament. It's used over there in Deuteronomy chapter 3, for instance. When we come to the Nephilim are mentioned, and it's the earliest account anywhere in the Scripture that they're mentioned. Now, if Job was written before Genesis, that would have preceded the actual writing of this. But the first account is in Genesis chapter 6. And the word Nephilim is actually a transliteration right there in your Bible, which means they didn't translate the word to its original intent. They just transliterated it, so it sounds the same. Literally, we believe that the root of that word actually means the fallen ones. And so that's an important point for us to stop and to think of them. They were the sons of Anak, and they were then the descendants of him. We're going to hear about them a little bit more. And then other giants such as Anakim is also mentioned. What I'd like for you to do is take your Bibles and go with me, though, now to that earliest reference of these giants in all of the Bible, which is Genesis chapter 6. Genesis, the sixth chapter, mentions these Nephilim. And the context in which they're mentioned is fairly fascinating. I'm going to read for you this passage starting here in verse 1, and you'll notice with me some interesting things. It came about, it says, when men began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves, whomever they chose. And the Lord said, "My spirit shall not strive with man forever, because he also is flesh. Nevertheless, his days shall be 120 years." The Nephilim were on the earth in those days. And also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. Well, this was a huge, huge problem back here in Genesis chapter 6. In the days of Noah, this is a terrible, terrible event, leading to a tidal wave of violence and wickedness on the earth that was so violent and so wicked that there was no remedy for this whatsoever other than the utter destruction of mankind. Now, this is one of the most difficult passages in all of the Scriptures. Because when we look at this passage, we have to try to determine who exactly is spoken of there when it mentions the sons of God. And you go back there to verse 2. The sons of God saw the daughters of men were beautiful. Well, there's three potential views that have been floated out there. And I'm going to tell you what I'm leaning towards and the reason why I believe what I believe. But let me just say this. There is a general consensus that we really can't be 100% sure. And I'm not sitting here this morning trying to tell you that I'm 100% sure. But I want you to know what the background is, because there is something to consider here, because this is such a horrible event that takes place. This is what leads up to the destruction of humanity and the salvation that comes through the ark which God provides. Sons of men. Bene Elohim. It could be, and these are the three main ideas that are floated. One is that this is speaking of nobility, the sons of God, and the daughters of men is that of a commoner. And so you have a marriage between nobility and commoners. I think that's pretty much thrown out, because when you stop and you consider that, there's no prohibition of that in Scripture. I mean, I married my wife because she was rich, and, you know, I'm just... She had like 50 bucks. So I was poor. I was just a poor seminary student. And she had a job. That's a whole nother story. In all seriousness, this could not be the reason why God destroys humanity. The second reason that's floated out there is that the sons of God is speaking of the Sethites. That is a righteous group of individuals coming from the descendants of Seth, who were then marrying with the daughters of men who were considered to be unregenerate, wicked people. And that is a largely held view as well. I see problems with that view that cause me to question. I question, where are those descendants of Seth when the ark is being filled up and all you have is Noah and his family? What happened to those righteous people? I look at that as well here and wonder if the third view has any plausibility, because the third view kind of goes outside the box. And that's the idea that these sons of God were actually a reference to fallen angels. Now, when you stop and you think of sons of God and you link them with fallen angels, usually we put up a red flag and say, no, that cannot be the possibility. And the reason for that is, when we think of the sons of God, what do we think of today in 2017? Well, in a New Testament mindset, when we think of being a child of God, we think of someone who's regenerated, someone who's saved, someone who loves the Lord. Oh, the sons of the Lord, these are the children of God. In fact, they're gathered here at Faith Community Church this morning on this wonderful day in February. So here we are, you know, and this is great. But the reality is that it's not speaking of this in the Old Testament. In fact, this is the only place in the Old Testament where this phrase is actually used. It's never used of the Sethites that they were somehow sons of God. It's only a New Testament concept when you push it further forward, and then it takes on its whole nother meaning. The only other places that are similar when it talks about the sons of God would be over in Job, for instance. And in both of those occasions, it's speaking of an angel, and without question, both of those are angels. Daniel chapter 3, it's speaking actually there of either an angel or a theophany. And so the idea of sons of God, I want you to rethink this in your mind a little bit. The reason for sons of God is the descendants of God. This is where God has created them directly. So the only persons who would actually be considered sons of God would be the angels who God created, or Adam. So those would be considered those who God directly created. All the others, you and I, are descendants of humanity. We've all followed on down from Adam, okay? And so as we look at this, we say, oh, interesting. But one of the things that stands out when you look at this passage is the devil has this amazing plan to corrupt humanity. In fact, the only righteous line now is through Seth, and he's trying to destroy even that. And so the wickedness in the earth is so great, it's so bad, that God makes this statement. Notice verse 5, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What a profound statement. The only things that went through man's mind were evil thoughts. It was so bad that the Bible says the Lord was sorry he made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. And the Lord said, I'll blot out man whom I've created from the face of the land, man the animals, creeping things, birds of the sky. I'm sorry I've made them. And then we have hope in verse 8. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. For it says there in verse 9, Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his time, and Noah walked with God. Whew. Now that's amazing, isn't it? I mean, we came this close to not being here, right? That's right. Now, trying to put this together and trying to figure out this whole aspect of the sons of God, I want you to go over and find the little book of the Bible before the last book, which is the book called Jude. Jude writes this, and Jude is just one of these books of Scripture that is just absolutely loaded. It is just absolutely loaded. He talks about things that make you scratch your head and wonder, what in the world is he talking about? Jude begins to write this book, and it's curious. It says there that he's a bondservant of Christ and brother of James. He identifies himself, and he says, to those who are called beloved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ, may mercy and peace be loved, multiplied to you. And he says in verse 3, this is what I'm writing this for. Beloved, while I was making every effort to write you about our common salvation, this was his purpose. Jude wanted to write about their salvation that they have in Christ. This is not someone whose salvation has grown stale. He is excited to write about the salvation, and I'm excited to hear about it. But he said, I felt necessary to write to you appealing that you contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all handed down to the saints. Ooh, all of a sudden it went from, this is going to be a cheery book about the grace of God and salvation, to all of a sudden, we got a heavy issue here and you need to contend for the faith. Ooh, all of a sudden, big change. And he goes on and he says, for certain persons, and this is why he admonishes the readers of this to contend for the faith. He says, certain persons have crept in unnoticed who were long beforehand marked out for this condemnation. They're ungodly persons who turn the grace of our God into licentiousness and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. What Jude sees is an assault on the very gospel itself. He sees immoral behavior, this licentiousness that he describes, as creeping into the church, and it is an unfortunate disaster. He says that these are people who were actually marked out for this from the beginning. Satan is at work, isn't he? And he is trying to do a mighty work here. And Jude says, we need to contend for the faith because we're slip-sliding away. And then he points to something very interesting. He says, I desire to remind you, though you know all things once for all. I like that because what Jude is saying is, I know you guys already know this, but I want you to know it. I want you to hear it again from me. I know you're aware of it. And I'm sitting there as I'm reading this as a student in 2017, and I'm going, no, tell me more about it because I don't know everything about it. He goes on and he says this. He says, the Lord, after saving a people out of the land of Egypt, subsequently destroyed those who did not believe. Ooh, okay. What's he talking about there? He's talking about the people of Israel. After they came out of Egypt, they looked at the promised land, 10 of those spies, ooh, no, we're not going. And there was a problem. And there was a rebellion, and God said, that's it. You're not going to go into the promised land. You're going to wander in the wilderness. You're going to hang out in Kadesh Barnea until this generation is no longer alive, and then I'll take the remnant in to the promised land. And so God judged them. And this is the significance here. He's talking about this judgment, and basically he's saying that these who are licentious, these people who have crept in unawares into the body of Christ, who are pulling the gospel down and integrating things that are not true and falsehoods and destroying even the essence of the gospel, he says they are going to be judged just like the people of Israel who did not believe God were judged. Then he goes on and he says, and angels who did not keep their own domain, but abandoned their proper abode, he has kept in eternal bonds under darkness for the judgment of the great day. Now, I would take that as I read it, and I would say, well, that's true. The angels that fell into sin, that revolted against God, who thought that they could join Satan and rebel, they're judged by God as well. And so we have these who are licentious, they need to be judged by God, because I want to remind you, the people of Israel who did not believe were judged by God, and certainly the angels who fell were judged by God. And then he says, here's the third group. He says, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, since they in the same way as these indulged in gross immorality and went after strange flesh, are exhibited as an example in undergoing the punishment of eternal fire. Now here's what catches my attention. So he's going to say, here's a group that's judged, people of Israel who didn't believe, the angels who rebelled against God. And then he goes and he says, the cities around Sodom and Gomorrah, including Sodom and Gomorrah, who were also judged and destroyed. He says, since they in the same way as these, that is those who are Sodom and Gomorrah. And it would appear that he's talking here about these angels who in the same way indulged in gross immorality and went after strange flesh. Well, if that has a reference to Genesis chapter 6, it would put a lot more credibility in the view that the sons of God, the B'nai Elohim, are actually fallen angels. Here's what's interesting to me. Jude references in verse 14 Enoch, and he mentions Enoch's writings. There's Enoch 1, there's Enoch 2. Both of those are apocryphal books. They're filled with Jewish tradition. There were a lot of other books that are also part of Jewish tradition. Jewish tradition exclusively holds the idea that Genesis chapter 6 is actually a reference to these angels that were fallen. How they did what they did, I can't explain. Probably one of the biggest barriers to believing that these are angels is the fact that Jesus would say in Matthew that when in heaven, you're going to be like the angels. There's no giving in marriage or being married in heaven. And so we wonder, well, the angels aren't male and female in that sense, although every time there's an angel reference in Scripture, it's a male reference. Trying to put that all into perspective, I understand that there's no marriage in heaven for angels. But when an angel takes on human form, what is he capable of? We know that the angels who met with Abraham did what with Abraham and Sarah? They ate with them, right? We know that the angels who visited Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah were sought after and lusted after by the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. Is it possible for these angels to take on a bodily form that is not neutral and so corrupt humanity, leading to the Nephilim, who then are leading to wickedness and violence in the world to such a great degree that Satan might get his wish, and God would have to destroy all mankind? Well, it's pretty heavy stuff. I want you to see this morning that the giants were always at the center of the battle, that they were a tool used by Satan over time to corrupt humanity, and specifically the people who followed God. Take your Bible and let's go over to 1 Samuel in the Old Testament. 1 Samuel chapter 16 is where we pick up the situation there with a little shepherd boy by the name of David. At this point in time, we meet David. The Bible says Samuel in verse 13. I'm in 1 Samuel 16 in verse 13. And Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Now move over to chapter 17, and I'll show you what's going on. In chapter 17 and verse 1, the Philistines gathered their armies for battle, and they were gathered at Soko, which belongs to Judah. They encamped between Soko and Azekah. Saul and the men of Israel were gathered and encamped in the valley of Elah. And they drew up in battle array to encounter the Philistines. And the Philistines stood on the mountain on one side. Israel stood on the mountain of the other side. with the valley in between, and the champion came out from the armies of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Now, where did we already read about Gath? Well, you go back over to Joshua chapter 11, and you read in our text this morning that the Anakim were cut off. They were fully uprooted, destroyed from Debir to Anab. And he goes on and he says, from the hill country in Israel, Joshua utterly destroyed them. There was no Anakim left in the land, the sons of Israel, only in Gaza and Gath and Ashdod. So there were a few left. So there is Goliath, 9 feet 9 inches. He might have been a nice guy and could have played basketball, you know what I mean? But the Bible describes the tip of his spear as weighing 15 pounds and the spear itself being like a weaver's beam. It's like throwing a 4x4 with a 15-pound piece of lead at the end of it. And he was able to do that, and so he would come down, and the Bible describes him taunting the people of Israel. He should get a penalty for taunting. But every day he came down and he said, which one of you is going to come down and fight me? And here's the deal. You beat me and we're your servants. I beat you and you serve us. So come on down. And the Bible says the leadership was emboldened and men of faith. Bible describes it in verse 11, and it says, when Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistines, they were dismayed and they were greatly afraid. Somebody called a whambulance. Here these great men are. Where is your faith in God? You see what the devil was doing? The devil was using fear to grip the hearts of these leaders. And so they were paralyzed by this fear, and every single day they were taunted by the enemy, and Satan was gaining the victory. The devil knows that fear can absolutely paralyze us. It could be something as simple as just sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with someone. We know we need to share the good news, but we're gripped by fear. We're afraid to open our mouth for Jesus. We're afraid to do the right thing in certain circumstances. We have this fear that just pervades our world. We can all relate to times when we've been afraid, when we've been scared. I remember as a young man working for a police department, walking the main street of Chatham, Massachusetts, and I remember being assigned the task of going and jiggling the doorknobs in the shopkeepers' businesses, and you'd walk down these alleys and you'd go to the back door and make sure that they locked up properly. It was a service that the town did for the shopkeepers. I remember one night, it was one of those real dark, misty nights, you know. And I remember I had my little flashlight, got my Kelblade, and I go walking up through the alleyway, and there was something in the alleyway, and I didn't like it. It turned out it was this Doberman pincher, and I mean, this thing was... And my heart went right up into my throat. It's like, I just looked at him and I thought, I'm going to be eaten. And then I remembered I had my gun. So I knew I wouldn't be eaten. But I just walked backwards carefully. And I left him in there and I figured, he can guard the shopkeepers. And nobody's going in there to rob him tonight. I remember another time I was in a tree with my bow and arrow. And I was looking, and I could see at a distance of a huge black bear. And he was standing on his back legs, and he was eating berries off of a tree. And I thought, man, that is one cool-looking bear. I mean, I think all bears are cool. But this bear, he bared watching. I went over there after I got done, and he was gone, just totally evaporated into thin air. And I thought, what happened to this bear? And I made my way for my truck, and as I was walking past an old building that was 100 years old plus, and it had just kind of rotted to the point where it just caved in on itself, if you know what I mean. And there were about two walls still standing. And as I was walking past the building, I had my bow in my right hand, I looked over into the window that was still there, and the bear was standing in the window. And I thought, Oh, there's a bear standing in the window. I was 5 feet away from this black bear. And he decided to jump out the window, which I thought was a lousy idea. So he put his front paws down on the windowsill, and when he did that, I'm looking at him, and I'm going, and he puts his front paws on it, and the whole thing just caves in, just, it was all rotted wood. And I hear this crash, and I just turned and walked away, and I waited to be hit from the back. And I took about 3 steps, and I turned around. My throat is filled with my heart once again, and I thought to myself, it's over. I turned around, I didn't get hit, and I thought, he's gone. He was one invisible bear at times. And I guess he ran off. I guess he looked at me and thought, man, that guy's, you know, what is he doing here? And I'm going to get away from him. But he was a nice bear, and we were able to get along well after that. I'm telling you, there are times in our lives when we are petrified at things. And sometimes it's those physical types of things, but oftentimes it's things that are spiritual. Oftentimes it's where God asks us to do something, and we're so paralyzed by the idea of it that we won't even trust the Lord to provide for us so that we can get on through. Well, Numbers chapter 13, I'd like you to look there, because this is a tactic of Satan. He loves to cause us to have fear, and the fear continues on here in Numbers chapter 13, where the people of Israel, again, are tasked with something of great importance, and yet they find that the fear is just overwhelming them and gripping them. Here in chapter 13, we have the word of the Lord coming to Moses saying, "Send out for yourself men so that I might spy out the land of Canaan, which I'm going to give to the sons of Israel." We know that God says, okay, from each tribe, there's going to be a leader who's going to come. They're going to go into the land, and the list of all of these names are given. Moses gives him an order. He tells him in verse 17 to spy out the land of Canaan. He tells him where to go and all these different things. He says, I want to know what the land is like, whether the people are strong or they're weak, whether there's a lot or few. How's the land? Is it good or bad land? How are the cities? Are they fortified or are they open? How is it? Is it fat or lean, this land? Are there trees in it or not? And he says to them, make an effort then to get some of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes, and they went up and they spied out the land. And when they'd gone up into the Negev, they came to Hebron, where Ahiman, Sheshai, and Talmai, the descendants of Anak, were. They also came to the valley of Eshcol, verse 23, and from there they cut down a branch with a single cluster of grapes and carried it on a pole. And I mean, it shows you how rich this land is. But it's noteworthy that verse 22 stands out, that when they went up into that land, they came to a place where the descendants of Anak were. When they returned, the Bible says they started to give their report. And while there was some positives from a couple of the godly men, they say in verse 28, nevertheless, the people who live in the land are strong and the cities are fortified and large. And moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Amalek is living in the land of the Negev, and the Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites living in the hill country, the Canaanites by the shore. And Caleb quieted the people and he said, we should go up. But verse 31 says, the men who had gone up with him said, we're not able to go up against the people, for they're too strong for us. So they gave out to the sons of Israel a bad report. They said, the land through which we've gone and spying out is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people who we saw in it were men of great size. There also we saw the Nephilim. Remember chapter 6 and verse 4. And we became, he says, like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight. You'll notice there that they were like grasshoppers in whose sight first? In their sight. The way they perceived themselves were, we're small. We're so tiny. How big is a grasshopper anyway? They're little. They can be annoying, but they're small. What's the big deal? Well, I know that in the giant's viewpoint, they would look at the Israelites and they would say, they're like grasshoppers. But why is it that the people of Israel look at themselves that way. You see, they should have never looked at themselves that way. In fact, Joshua and Caleb didn't look at themselves that way. They didn't say, we're grasshoppers. They said, we're more than conquerors. And that is the difference between the people who live by faith and the people who are gripped by fear. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of these giants. I'm glad we don't have three services and I have to preach about them again. I mean, these are just, this is rottenness. This is Satan trying to do everything he can. And so from that point, when the people saw these giants, they stepped back in great fear, and we know how things unraveled for the people of Israel after that. They refused to listen to Joshua and Caleb. They ultimately rebel against God, and it is Joshua and Caleb then who take the people of Israel, who are the descendants of these doubters, into the promised land. Satan has done everything that he can to use things in the people's lives that would discourage them and cause them to be greatly afraid. The inhabitants of the land devour people. Like, seriously, they don't eat people. But that was the view. And the fear was just terror. It was an absolute terror, and they were all awestruck of what was before them. There are many times in our Christian lives when we need to be reminded about the faithfulness of God, don't we? And that's why, as I go back to Joshua chapter 11, there is great significance here as I read this passage. In verse 23, so Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses. Isn't that awesome? The victory's been won. What God said he would do, he has done. Even though there were giants in the land, even though at times they were gripped by fear, ultimately it took people who were willing to trust the Lord to overcome that fear. And what we have in Joshua and Caleb are not superhuman people of faith. They are people who believed in God. They're people who know God and trust God enough to take step after step in following him. And guess what happened? God was faithful. Guess what happened? God delivered these people into their hands just as he said he would. This is our God. The people of God should not be paralyzed by fear. We should be people of faith, amen? Because God is waiting to work in your life. He wants to show his faithfulness in your world. He wants you to know what he is capable of. Those who desire to walk with the Lord times may experience fears, but the fear does not paralyze them. It translates into a faith in Almighty God, you see. There have been many people who probably wondered about the outcome of their actions as they followed the Lord. You read great autobiographies of great Christians, and the accounts are given. Those people trusted God, and God always came through for them in amazing ways. That is our God. Oh, how I trust we will be people of faith and not people of fear. Let's pray. I mentioned earlier what it means to be a child of God, what it means to have faith in Almighty God. And I trust this morning that you're here today and you've placed your faith in Jesus Christ. But if you've yet to do that, how I encourage you this morning to make that decision to place your faith in Jesus Christ and in him alone. And if you're here today and you are a follower of Christ, I encourage you today to acknowledge areas of fear that Satan has put in your life. Maybe you're here this morning and God spoke in your heart and you say, Pastor Kevin, God is really speaking to my heart about areas that I'm just kind of paralyzed in. And I know I need to draw close to God. I know I need to trust the Lord. I wonder if I can pray for you this morning and say, Pastor Kevin, God is speaking to my heart about some things, and he and I know what they are, and I know I need to trust him about it. Is there anyone this morning? Just slip up your hand if I can pray for you. I will. Amen. Many hands. Amen. Amen. God is faithful, folks. Those few verses at the end of this chapter, they spoke volumes. They were huge verses to the people of Israel. I'm sure they wondered if they'd ever get to that place, and sure enough, God led them there. God will take you and I through the areas of concern that we have. We can be assured of that. Father in heaven, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for your great faithfulness to us. I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone here this morning who's yet to place their faith in Christ and Christ alone, that they would today understand the significance of that decision and trust you. Father, for these who've asked for prayer, who are dealing with things that just have them really concerned, and there's fear and maybe an uncertainty, Lord, how I pray that you would draw near to them, that they would come to trust you for the outcome that you have for them. Lord, give us all that measure of strength and courage this morning, I pray, that we might please you in Jesus' name. Amen.